here, Coco, come here. She's, you know what? She doesn't get along with a cat. You're going to lose, Coco. Don't do it. Come here, Coco. Yeah, she won't do it. Come here, Coco. Say hi to everybody. Can you see her? There she is.
Yeah.
Hi, Coco. Yeah, having a puppy. That was a smart idea. That was good.
Hi, I'm Jamil Smith, senior writer for Rolling Stone magazine. Today, I spoke with journalist Soledad O'Brien about her new podcast, about racial and gender representation in media, and about the Trump administration. Just as a caveat, we spoke before the final presidential debate, if it actually happened. Enjoy. Soledad, first, tell me about this podcast that you have going.
Yeah, you know, I think what we were really interested in is understanding the point of view, but not of people who politically just yell at each other, right? I really wanted people who felt something deeply, who were really, really engaged and had a point they wanted to get across. But I've very much enjoyed in the now 32 years that I've been in this business, kind of getting the inside scoop from people who are not the boldface names. It's actually worked out really well for me in most of the projects that I've done is to go find interesting people and elevate their stories. Sometimes I do think you need reporters who are going to give you context and explain things, but I've really liked having this idea that as reporters and journalists, we can be the teaching hospital. Like we can explain to people, here's what it is, here's someone to hear from, they're going to give you context. They're going to explain the issue. You're going to get their point of view. They feel it very deeply, but I really wanted, you know, I wanted to be about regular people. And so we're just starting now. The podcast is just launched and we started looking at voting and we're going to take a look at sort of big issues that deal with policy or politics, but through the eyes of regular people. So everybody can find us on Quake Media. So you can just, we're part of a package that Quake has just launched and it's called Very Opinionated with Soledad O'Brien, which I think some people think means that I'm very opinionated, which I kind of am, but the actual podcast is about elevating those people who feel things very deeply, who they are very opinionated and we get to talk to them about the things that they're opinionated about. Then I can come on your show and talk about things I'm opinionated about.
Yes. Well, you are here to talk about your opinions to some degree. And let's get started with that. I think, you know, there's been, I guess, an evolution in your career since, you know, you left CNN and, you know, what have you, that I guess you've been, I guess, a little bit of a media critic as you've gone on and continued with Starfish and, you know, continue with HBO Sports. Tell me a little bit about how you feel media has evolved or devolved, especially during the Trump presidency.
Certainly in political journalism, I think is really challenged. They were challenged in how to cover Donald Trump. They were challenged in how to think about pushing back on a guy who refused to answer questions and would actually belittle in a big way the interviewer. That's always challenging. And I don't think in the last 4 years, remember, we've never left campaign mode. You know, normally the way it works is there's an election, there's an inauguration, all the political journalists kind of go away, and every so often it's like, it's infrastructure week. Bob Jones joins us from the White House. But now every single story is framed through the lens of really the White House correspondence pool. And I think that's really not good for the nation. I don't think covering a pandemic from the point of view of a horse race and who's winning and who's losing and whose positioning is good for America. I think it's actually bad. Now, I say that because I think reporting generally has been excellent. I love reporters. I like reporting. But I do think the political reporters have been very challenged in how to deal with President Trump. And I have not seen them learn a lot of the lessons that I think they could have learned about proportionality, about maybe slowing things down and fact-checking before they jump on social media, about really thinking about the kind of stories that they're trying to tell. I don't think those things have really been learned. That said, I think there's been some phenomenal reporting. Gosh, the New York Times reporters who did the story on Trump's taxes, they were great. And that was an 18-month investigation. And they do that beautifully. But I think some other things have really been lacking. So I'm critical frequently of media, but I think there is a real job of media critic. And I think like Margaret Sullivan does it really well. And a handful of other people do a really good job of like actual media criticism, right? They don't just tweet, they write columns and have thoughtful conversations about it. I occasionally pen an op-ed and generally just in anger tweet and try to actually, I feel like my audience is younger journalists, so I can say, let me show you where this interview went awry. Let me show you where this this piece, this, you know, column, this story is not good. And that's what I think I can add, just because I have experience in the business. My job is not at all media critic. I mean, I get to do it for free on Twitter sometimes, but like I run a production company and we've got shows in production and I anchor a show and I'm a correspondent on another show. So I try to juggle all of those things with an eye to, I think people have lost a lot of trust in institutions, including media. And I try to explain maybe why that is and where maybe where we could do a better job.
I mean, there's this myth of objectivity. And of course, you know, the news itself and people's perception of public affairs and politics and current events. What do you think the impact of that is? And especially in this particular era?
The idea of objectivity, right, was not so much being objective. It was more like, make sure you match the point of view that we, the people who run this place, have. So we believe these things. So you will do fine if you too believe these things. And we're going to call that kind of the point of view that is comfortable for our audience. So it's not so much objective as just a comfortable point of view that is somebody's bias, because we all have bias. It's just a bias that everybody feels cool about because everybody else around them has the same bias. I think a good example of that is, you know, I think even news organizations that would swear to you that they're very objective, we often, and certainly I did too, when we would go to the police to allow them to frame the entire story of a crime that had been committed, right? And you'd frame the entire thing. You'd interview the police chief. He would lay out what happened. He'd talk about the person they've arrested. They would tell you, you know, and then you'd go back and report that. And very rarely, I will speak only for myself, would we as an organization, but me specifically, would we say, well, huh, maybe these people have a dog in this fight. Like maybe they're not the most unbiased, objective people that we could be talking to. So often I think reporters, especially reporters of color, get in trouble, get criticized for going into neighborhoods, maybe neighborhoods that we're from or neighborhoods that we're comfortable in or neighborhoods that we know, and highlighting some of the things that the people in the neighborhood are saying, right? Like, oh, that's not really objective. Those are your people and you're not objective. When actually I think that objectivity is about being fair to the story and bringing all of those things that you have in your background to try to understand context and being deeply suspicious of everybody's point of view, recognizing that even if they're not trying to spin you, that they also might be just getting it wrong. It took me a really long time as a reporter to realize, like, maybe we shouldn't be covering the perp walk, that there's a reason that they're walking the guy around for the nice 11-second walk that allows me to get the top of my piece for the local news, right? Like, that's media and policing working hand in hand. I was, at the time, as a new reporter, I was grateful for that. Thank you for allowing me to cover my story. And everybody had three names. Jonathan Smithers Jones was captured, you know, and get 11 seconds to walk by. Well, I understand now, and I figured it out a few years into being a reporter, like maybe that's not the way to try to tell this story. Like maybe doing it the way we're doing it is not actually either effective or really fair to the people we're reporting on. So I think often we have these lofty conversations about, are we objective? But in life, we're not a particularly objective. I think the people who run newsrooms are not particularly objective. They just mean, do you see the world like I see the world? Because that'll make me comfortable.
On that point, I know you wrote in the New York Times op-ed section in July, in the midst of the civil rights uprising that began, of course, in the midst of the deaths of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and others, that this is a Me Too moment for journalists of color. And being one myself, yeah, I understand what you meant, but can you explain what that means within the context of your career and for those who didn't get a chance to read it?
Yeah, I think that often as a journalist of color, you understand how the people in the community are feeling. And often the newsroom is kind of reporting a story a different way or elevating the voices. This happens all the time, right? A bunch of guys, usually white guys, mm-hmm. sitting around talking about an issue. Let's talk about the black vote. And you're like, okay, maybe some black person should just walk through this conversation for a minute. The number of times I have done, and I have been part of this, the Latino vote on election night, it goes like this. Now to Texas for a look at the Latino vote. Here's a story. We come out joining us now, Soledad, Jose, and Esmeralda for a look at, right? And we all chat for a little bit and then we're invited off. Thank you very much. The Latino vote, very, very important. Back to you, right? Like this idea that we're, and you're laughing because you've seen it 5 million times, right? And I've done it 5 million times.
Right.
So, to me, it feels like you have these little silos and that your voice is not necessarily entrenched in the conversation that's happening, right? Because we look at, even in cities where minorities are the majority, they're still treated like, then we're going over here, we'll take you to this foreign land in this community. And you're like, well, actually in this city, minorities are the majority. So I just think our coverage of how we think about communities of color and how we talk about them and how we elevate them and how we often leave them out of the narrative is problematic. And I think reporters of color are starting to point it out. It's very hard to have someone in a newsroom, and this happened to me when I was at CNN, you know, tell you that the idea that Black parents treat their children differently than white parents when it comes to policing. I've had executives at CNN tell me that's just not true. And you're like, no, let me tell you it is true. I can just tell you that is true. One, did a documentary on it. But two, I have two brothers. So let me tell you. And I grew up in a white neighborhood. So let me tell you how different it is, right? So I think the challenge for journalists of color and what I meant for it by a Me Too movement is that reporters were sort of saying we're no longer going to stand by and act as if the one point of view is a white point of view, that our audience is all white and we are speaking to white people, white middle class people. They're valuable to us. They matter to us. And that's our audience. I think there are plenty of reporters now who say, actually, no, there's a different point of view here. It's kind of interesting. And I'd like to elevate that in this discussion.
You did Black in America at CNN well before, you know, we entered this period where, you know, more journalism was being put through a Black lens, a Hispanic and Latinx lens. Can you tell me a little bit what that experience was like for you?
Yeah, part of it was great. I loved it. I was assigned the documentary series. We did it for 9 years, but I didn't come up with it. So they just asked me if I would do it. I loved doing it, but it was also a lot of fighting all the time because I think sometimes the lens was often about dysfunction. So in the Black community, the idea was when we started doing drafts of it, it was all, look at the data on this, the data on this, the data on this. And I would say to them, but you know, if you talk to actual Black people, you know, like people are not moping around. I think they're realistic. I think there's more texture to the stories that we need to tell. So it was a wonderful project, but it was often a fight. And I'll give you an example. We did a story on Dr. Steve Perry. He's the principal at Capital Prep Magnet School in West Hartford, Connecticut. And there was a young woman named Gloria Smenefee. And we did a beautiful story on this girl trying to get into college, poor girl from West Hartford. And when the first draft of the script was written, the producer, who's a wonderful young woman, had written, Gloria Smenefee's mother is a crack addict and her father is an alcoholic. And I can guarantee you that if we were writing that story about little Johnny Smith from suburban New Jersey and he was white, it would be little Johnny Smith loves baseball. Derek Jeter is his favorite player. And he's right now, we're following him around while he does his paper route, because people even do that anymore, because he's trying to raise money so he can get a mitt and blah, blah, blah. Right. And when we imbue that kid with a lot of agency, right? And we tell his story through his point of view. Poor people, especially poor people of color, they're a compilation of all the dysfunction in their lives, right? So we frame the white kid as an asset and we frame the Black kid as a deficit. She's framed with all the deficits. And so pretty clearly when you start seeing these things, you start recognizing like, oh, deficit framing, deficit framing, deficit framing. Oh, asset framing, asset framing. And you see who we asset frame and who we you know, picture as a giant bag of all the problems, not even necessarily their problems, problems of their community, problems their parents have, problems their neighbors have. So to me, you know, those things are actual fights. They were actual fights. When we did Latino in America, this is a terrible story, but I did Latino in America. So we sat around the table for the first project, probably 15 people around a big giant table. And we started the conversation trying to figure out, was it 48 million Americans or 51, depending on whether or not you counted Puerto Ricans as Americans. And we were like, I was in the meeting with one other Latina named Rose, who works with me now. And we're like, but we can Google this. Like, Puerto Ricans are American. And I was so anxious. It was ridiculous. But I was also thinking, like, I'm about to start a doc project called Latino in America with people who literally have no idea about Latinos in America. And we're having a debate about something that we could just Google and move on. And I left that meeting and I went upstairs to the president's office and I'm like, we need a different team. And you could argue for those things. I could, because I had a decent amount of power. Like, I had some leverage. But often if you're, you know, don't have a ton of leverage, you kind of get what you get. And that means that the framing is often just off or weird or inaccurate. And so I think it's a good argument for how you have to think about those stories, but also who needs to be around the table telling those stories. You know, if you sent me out to go do a story on young Vietnamese women in Texas, right? I mean, the first thing I would do is go find some young Vietnamese women, right? And start with them and make them my experts, and they would be my way into the community. But often that doesn't happen. People are like, no, I think I know this story. I got it. I don't do that. I never do that. I'm always like, I don't got it. Step one, find some people who could be my guides to a community that I might not know well. I've always been a little bit surprised by that.
Yeah. I mean, too often I feel like within our industry, so many people wing it on the stereotypes that they've either learned from popular media, you know, whether it comes from, you know, the television shows that they may have watched, where, you know, like the Black person or the Latino person was like the side character on the television show that they liked.
Or killed, if it's Star Trek, killed early.
Right. Yeah. They were the red shirt, you know, in the first 10 minutes of Star Trek. Or they were, you know, just maybe the one person that they barely knew in class. And, you know, having been that person, I know that experience. So, you know, and I've seen those people, you know, either sometimes learn from their mistakes or, you know, go on to make more of them. So it's, you know, it's refreshing to now see this moment where we have gained more leverage in this industry to make those choices and to push further to, like you said, to have our own teams and to now be asked to, you know, have a little bit more input on these kind of personnel choices. That being said, though, it's a lot of weight being brought to bear on us. And now it's like, okay, all right. The question I have for you is, you know, a lot of them are now coming to us and saying, hey, can you help us build these networks of journalists of color? And I feel like to some extent, I want these decision makers to, you know, say like, hey, these journalists of color have been begging you for jobs or like been sending you resumes all this time. Can you please go out and build your own networks? It's not my job to help you find them.
It's called a consulting fee, right? And someone needs to right. pay you for it. And they also need to make it fun so that people want to work there, right? It's not just a matter of, I have six Black friends and do they want to come into this company? It's what is this company doing to show the friends that I have that this might be a worthwhile place to work? So I completely agree. And as you know, there was that funny joke after the killing of George Floyd. Actually, I remember it was so stressful and so difficult and so terrible that people would say, like, stop talking to your Black friends. Like, stop asking them questions and asking them to explain issues. Send them a fruit basket, went the joke. Send them a fruit basket and leave them alone like that. And I used to think, like, you know, it's so accurate. Like, who wants to be the person who's shouldering the responsibility? I had so many very nice people who are like, can I talk to you about race relations in America? I'm like, oh Lord, not today. Honestly, it's a really, we're in a pandemic. It's a rough, no, you cannot. Right. On the other hand, if you don't agree to have some of these conversations, then who does have that conversation? Right? If someone genuinely is trying to figure it out, then who does help them navigate that? And if they genuinely want to hire people.
On some occasions with friends, I pushed and I did it. And then some occasions where I just had to opt out and I had to say, you know, not today, you know, I just can't do it. And
you know what's been interesting though? I was giving a talk to the folks at this big insurance company and they invited their Black executives to speak to the entire company. One of the guys who's a great guy, funny, high level executive, Black guy. And he told the story of, he said, I want everybody in the company to hear this story. And he told the story of one day hearing a noise in his basement. goes down to the basement and the back door in the basement is open. And he's thinking like, did I leave it open? Did someone just break into my house? Or maybe I just like accidentally left it half done and it opened the rest of the way. And he described, but almost like half joking, he was like, I don't know if I should call the cops because I'm worried that if I call the cops, they're going to come to my house and they're going to kill me. And it was the most poignant and moving and sad and remarkable story, right? And he's telling it like almost with a smile and a laugh, like, isn't this the craziest thing? And I actually think on that day, he moved the needle for a lot of his white colleagues who can't imagine, can't even like wrap their head around the idea that if you call the cops, there's a decent chance that it could end so poorly for you as a person who's worried that you've been victimized, right? I mean, he was just concerned that someone might be in his house. And that would make you actually choose to close the door and hope for the best and not ask the police to come to your house. And I thought, I'm not sure you could move the 3,000 people or whoever were in that meeting in a way more than he did, right? Like, I think they knew him, they got him, he's Mr. Happy-go-lucky, super nice, successful guy. And they were like, holy shit. Wow. Like, yeah, we had no idea that like this guy is going through that. You know, we know those guys over there who, you know, maybe they don't have jobs or maybe they look a little suspicious. They're not all Girl Scouts, you know, but this guy, like he has. And right. I thought the fact that he was so vulnerable was actually really helpful. But I'm sure it takes a lot out of him, too. It's not easy to do that. It's exhausting. That's why we drink.
And guess what? We're all looking suspicious. And that's the whole point. And that's what we've been trying to express for so very long. But that's a powerful story. The professional impact, we're talking a little bit about jobs and networks. The professional impact we've seen on careers, you know, from speaking out, from being vocal. Have there been any professional impacts on you or people you've seen, you know, in your cohort from speaking out, from being vocal about the discrimination or issues that you've seen within media? And also, you know, have they been particular on women of color that you've seen?
Yeah, I think in general, women of color are constantly attacked in social media, like, you know, that's just a given. But if you're talking about like actual tangible specific impact on your career, for me, no, but really I didn't really start having these conversations until I'd been in the business for 30 something years, right? So a lot of the things that I probably would want to go do, I could do, I don't want to do. I've done them. I don't want to anchor a daily show. I really don't. And I've been asked and it's not where I am. I like having flexibility. I've liked running a company. It's a lot of fun. I like dipping into things that I want to do. So I've never felt like, oh, if I'd only, you know, been nicer on Twitter, I could be writing a column for the New York Times. Like that was never going to happen and it is never going to happen. And that's cool because I do not care if that happens. Zero interest. I think for me, it was about sticking to the things in the projects that I'm doing now. So, you know, I follow all the social media guidelines for my company, right? And I would never work for an organization, like be a full-time employee of a place where, you know, they said, here's what you're allowed to say, and here's what you're not allowed to say. You know, that's one of the reasons I'm not a full-time employee. I want to be able to have the voice that I want to have. That's a very tangible and specific choice. But I'm not 23 years old trying to build a career. I'm 54 years old, really, you know, trying to sort through what things I want to do and what things I should say no to. So I personally haven't really felt it. And also, I mean, I'm sure there's whole groups of like journalists in DC who all hang out together and go out to dinner with John Boehner or something. Like, I mean, I never was that person. I have four kids. So literally I was working or I was home, or I was working or I was on the road, or I was working, you know, like I never was part of this big, you know, group of that you see described in books sometimes of like journalists just all shooting the shit and talking about, you know, journalist things. And I didn't, I would go into the field in Haiti, be there for 3 weeks straight, come home as fast as I possibly can, hang out with my family, go back into the field. So I don't think anything sort of socially has changed for me. Partly we're all on lockdown anyway, but also that was never my scene. You know, I just had the friends that I had, some who were reporters and executives and some who were, you know, people who ran, you know, farms and farmers and then, you know, that is what it is. So I've never really felt like I've missed out on that either. And some of that I think is just, I've done it already. I don't want to be a network anchor. I've done it and I really enjoyed it. I loved working at CNN. I loved being a cable anchor. I loved traveling around the globe. I would never ever want to sit right now on a cable news desk and be the referee for two fighting congressmen. I think that would be sad. I do. I think that would be sad.
Yeah. Well, speaking of referee, I wanted to ask you, you know, by the time this is on our website or on YouTube, you know, we'll have either seen the last presidential debate or, you know, perhaps the president will have opted out. I wanted to know whether or not you either will have, you know, would have wanted to have had a crack at moderating one of these things or, and, you know, if so, what you would have done with that opportunity, you know, what?
No, you know, when I was younger, I did want to moderate a presidential debate, but only because it was like a feather in your cap. Not because I thought it was important. And it was back in the day when two people would actually answer questions for the most part. It wasn't a complete, you know, free for all. So, but it wasn't because I thought I was an amazing moderator of presidential debates or even because I thought I could get something out of the people that I was interviewing. I just think it was like one of those, and then I did this, and then I got this, and then I won this, and then I did this. And that was kind of how you grow your career. So I don't particularly have any interest in it. And I've moderated some, like the black and brown debates, which is sort of like a junior debate. So I've done some of those things, and they're fine. I do think it's going to be a mess. I think that the, you know, the idea that you can shut off somebody's mic for, you know, is going to be problematic because how do you decide whose mic you're shutting off? And you're going to still be able to hear people if they keep talking anyway. So I think it's going to, Kristen Welker, who I worked with, is smart and savvy and good. So I think she's going to have her hands full. But she's smart and savvy and good. So I think she'll do a good job controlling it. And she's kind of seen how the others have gone. So, you know, I think it'll be interesting to watch a little bit of it. But I've never of late had any interest in doing it. I thought the first debate that Chris did, I thought that was a mess. And I was surprised that he was surprised. He expressed surprise at how it went. I'm like, where have you been for the last... I don't know. Maybe it's just me. Like, hello, do you not watch anything on TV ever? So I was surprised by that. And that was a mess. And I think that I would have just shut it down. I mean, I really felt like my experience with four small children under four would have kicked right in and been like, you need to stop or I'm going to put you on a timeout. That's what that whole thing needed. I thought the NBC one was, you know, just kind of a mess in its own way. You know, what was portrayed as dueling town halls, which really weren't dueling town halls. I think the networks like to consider it dueling. And it'll be interesting to see what this one is. It's already setting up to be a mess. I think Kristen, though, if anybody can do it, she can do it. So I'm interested to see how it goes.
Yeah, I mean, two things off of that. I think, you know, first, Chris Wallace, just a real quick thing. I mean, there's the whole Mr. President, you will like this question thing that just, you know, made me nauseous, to be frank. I mean, just this softball treatment of this guy completely misunderstands the moment.
That's how it's been for the last 4 years because political journalists need access, right? That is the key. And so for the last 4 years, we've had people who want to make sure, do not upset the apple cart, right? We understand that the president is not going to be normal. And so we have to approach him like you'd have a marshmallow on a potato chip to make sure it's all fine. And that is problematic. And I think you see that a lot in the interviews. And I think you see that a lot in the articles, right? People know who they're writing for, who ultimately, you know, who's going to read what they're saying about him. So I think that's been very problematic from the White House press corps, to be honest.
I mean, but this is a guy who, I mean, we learned this week that more than 1,000 parents were, you know, separated from their children. And now 545 of those kids, will, you know, they don't know where the parents are. You know, I mean, this is not a person.
It's cool. And it's right. Well, but no. It is if you want an interview the next week. It is. And that's access journalism. And I think we have, again, I understand access journalism. I've never worked at the White House, so it's never been something that I've done. But if you need a scoop from a bold-faced name, then you better write nice things or at least frame things a certain way. Like that's how you trade in information. I think that's a problematic, especially for a person who lies constantly, because then you end up platforming lies and you undermine your own industry in the big picture, you know, slowly, while you're also trying to make sure you keep this person who's on the potato chip nice and comfortable.
Well, here's, I get to ask you a question. Actually, I'm really glad I get to ask you this question, because you were in a situation during, you know, Hurricane Katrina, where you got to ask somebody who was probably not going to tell you the truth, you know, a lot of really important questions and confront him in a meaningful way. So, of course, as people may recall, you got to interview FEMA Chief Michael Brown and confront him with, you know, in a way I thought that was really meaningful. How much of a value is there in interviewing a person like Donald Trump? Because the guy is going to lie to you.
I think there is a value, but I think it becomes your questions, right? So the Mike Brown example is a good one. Mike Brown is going to say, here's all the trucks we have going. We've done this, we've done that, right? And the key in that exchange was saying, but it's Friday. It's Friday. Like, you're spewing a lot of stuff that should have happened on Monday, but now it's Friday. And I think, if I remember correctly, I asked him, are you proud of the job that you've done, right? The act, you know, because that's the tricky question. How do you answer that? And he kind of, you know, mumbled and fumbled about it. And I think that was an interview where you got to see a person who's just in over his head and frankly just drowning, right? He was ticking off things, and it's like, those things, sure, but it's Friday. Let me give everybody some context. If they're buying what you're selling here, I'm going to remind them all that this is way too late for when it should be coming. So yeah, I do think there's a value. I actually think NBC should have done their town hall with Donald Trump. I just think what they did was a game, right? The game of pitting them against each other, which wasn't, again, if you think of like benefiting your viewers or benefiting your readers as kind of your North Star, I'm not sure how you explain that. Sure, he's the president, and things that he has to say are going to be important, but he doesn't mean he de facto gets to go live all the time. If someone's going to lie, then maybe we don't have to cover this live so that we platform those lies. We can take chunks of what he said, and we could even give him a full 45 minutes, but it has some shape and some framing, so we're not confusing people. And so I think a lot of that has been lost, like thoughtful ideas on how to cover somebody. We used to do this when David Duke was running for governor of Louisiana, you know, and the question was like, okay, so we got to cover him. He's running for governor, but also he's a white supremacist. So how do we cover a guy who's clearly going to use this platform to just spew hate? And I think the way we came to it was to be very careful and say, you know, he gets covered, but there's no rule that says we have to hand him the mic on live TV. Like, we don't have to do that. There's no rule that says we can't stop in the middle of his sentence, say, so we're going to stop here and explain to you what actually happened. You can do that. So I think somehow the news is always like, oh, but it's the president, we got to take him. It's like, you don't have to take him live. He absolutely is a newsmaker just by virtue of the fact that he's the president. But you actually have control in the way that you manage and package and present information. And I think sometimes they forget that.
Now, of course, we've seen how he handles those live, those interviews. I mean, when Jonathan Swan did an interview recently for Axios and, you know, seemed to really fry him on a number of points, he handled it a certain way. And when now Leslie Stahl.
Dying to see that. They haven't released that yet, have they? Because I've been busy
for the last
not. Couple hours.
No, they have not. And of course, you know, if you're watching this before Sunday's broadcast of 60 Minutes, you know, we're all eagerly awaiting that, but it's the president's treatment of her that is most compelling at this point.
Yeah, women obviously send him into a tizzy, obviously. Like, he really has a heart, and has for a long time. So yeah, I think that's something Kristen's going to have to think about and worry about. At the same time, I think the Trump team is very cognizant of the fact that, you know, he's losing suburban women, white suburban women, and, you know, beating up on women, metaphorically, is not going to be helpful to his campaign. So I'm sure they're also trying to figure out how to navigate that.
Yes. Yes. We emphasize metaphorically. And I just wanted to ask you, you know, in the op-ed that we mentioned before that you wrote for the Times, you know, you emphasize, you know, some, you know, your, you know, ability now to criticize your former employer, CNN. I want to get this right. You know, it's panel-driven journalism. That sometimes gives voice to liars and white supremacists, the excuse of balance to embolden and normalize bigots and bigotry by posing them as the other side. Now, I mean, first of all.
So, John Doe, you work with the Ku Klux Klan. You know, you've just heard what Congressman Smith said. What's your response, sir? Right? Like, that's it. Okay, so you might as well give that guy a platform. And somehow he gets to have an open mic. And this is a person who, by the way, would admit, right, who literally is. He's not lying about who he is. He's very clear. I think that's really, really problematic. So, yeah, I think, you know, that this idea of the both sides and also the idea that, listen, at the end of the day, I think it's money. It's just cheap to do TV that way. You just book that guy. You book that guy. Go at it. Oh, look at the time. We're going to have to leave it there. Thank you so much, sir. And, you know, that's, it's so cheap, 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 cheap. Yeah. Versus, we're going to send a crew. We're going to send a team. We're going to line up interviews. We're going to do a beautiful story that takes a long time to really dig into and understand. That's expensive. And so it really is just a, I think it's just a money issue, honestly.
Right. It not only is expensive, but it also requires critical thinking, which I just think there's a real dearth of in that industry. And I should also mention that CNN is my former employer, along with MSNBC. So, I mean, I have experience in this field and I understand the expediency within it. So, I, you know, it's an unfortunate aspect of the business, yes, but it doesn't mean it's not, there's not availability for improvement within it. I mean, there are people within it who do a good job of that. And there, so it's not impossible, you know,
yeah,
it's, it can be done.
The strategy is like, it's almost as if someone said, you know, conflict gets viewers, making people angry and happy sets off all these little things in the brain. And we know that from Fox News. So when, you know, brain studies. And so what can we do that everything is posed as this versus this? One of the things that I've liked about doing Matter of Fact, which is a show that I produce with Hearst, is because we're not live, we had to kind of lean into context because we can't cover stories that are breaking. We're not a live show. And it was very interesting to look at like the housing issue by going to follow a guy who's moved to Mexico from San Diego so that he can afford to live. And he works in San Diego, and he's American. Spanish is not his first language. Who come, you know, and like looking at the housing story through a regular person who has a story to tell. I have no idea if he's a Republican. I could not tell you if he's a Democrat. I don't know if he's voted, never voted, no idea, right? Because it's not really a partisan issue. It's just about the housing situation. It looks at policy, and when you stop, you know, looking at everything like, an, you know, if you have a hammer, what are they saying? If you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And I think if you have two seats and limited resources on a cable news show, then everything looks like a congressman and another congressman arguing, and you need to, and they tell you this. I mean, if you've ever been a guest on these shows, right, you're going to take the side of this. And you know what, this guy's going to say this. So we need you to take the side of this. This happened to me once at MSNBC where they said, like, you know, you're going to fight with Jose Diaz Balart about Castro. I'm like, I'm in the role of defending Castro. My mother fled Cuba. What? But I mean, it was so insane. Like, it was a Chris Matthews show. I never again ever went on his show again because I'm like, this is, and they said it in my ear right before we went live. And I'm like, in fact, Jose Diaz Balart kept saying to me, you know, Castro, whatever. I'm like, we agree. Yes, dictator, bad. Like, what? but you could tell, right? The booking was, you're going to be this, he's going to be that, and then you're going to go at it for 4 minutes, and then we're going to thank you, and then we're going to go, and then this is going to come on, there'll be this, and there'll be that, and you're going to go at it. You know, and I think it's this idea that conflict is good TV versus, I actually have found, and our show certainly does better than stuff on MSNBC and certainly on CNN, we found like people actually wanted to understand stuff. Well, how come if I have a First Amendment right, I can't just do that? You're like, well, actually, let me explain to you what the First Amendment is and is not. You know, gerrymandering. Yes, it's named after a guy named Jerry who drew a map like a salamander. Believe it or not, that's where gerrymandering came from. Let me explain to you what it means. And there's so much interesting history and context that we found that people actually wanted to understand it, that they didn't. I don't know. I hate the yelling, and I hate the elevating of people who are not experts. I do not care about what Rick Santorum has to say on anything, except for I'd be curious if he wanted to talk about what it's like to run for Congress and how much money it takes and how he had to think about his networks and elevating that. And, you know, like that would be interesting because that's his sphere, you know, his sphere of expertise. Any other thing, I do not care what he has to say. Nothing. Zero. Zero interest.
Yeah. Well, frankly, what it was like to lose office. That would be interesting.
Yeah, right.
Also
and how do you think about what your next job is going to be. Like, are you thinking the day you get into Congress, are you thinking about your next job? I mean, if you are young and you don't make a lot of money and you have four kids, like, come on, how do you navigate that? Is it, I got to stay in this job forever? Is it, I need to meet wealthy people so I can go to another job one day? Is it, I'm here to serve the people? I don't know, but he's an expert in that. And that actually, I think, would be really riveting to hear from him. But instead, he weighs in on things like climate change that he knows nothing about and he shouldn't be talking about.
Right, exactly. I wanted to ask you a little bit about, since we're on social media so much, how do you think social media continues to shape our business, for one, but also, public opinion, especially in this era?
Rudy Giuliani will be the two words I will say to them.
Now, that could mean a whole lot of things today.
And that's how I mean
it,
right?
We're talking about Wednesday.
How social media elevates the crazy story, the media chases after it, and so I think sometimes it's bad, sometimes it's interesting. I love social media, I really do. I like cutting out the middleman. I like having direct conversations with people. I think it's really helpful if you're a reporter to, you have to obviously ferret through what's real and what's not real, but usually it's an interesting place to start for conversations about something. So I've really enjoyed social media, but of course, I mean, it's insane. And now that none of us are sleeping, we're on social media all the time. It's extremely entertaining. I enjoy, following certain people. Ever since I got a puppy, I have a whole entire like separate puppy Twitter, which is like nice, lovely people. And whenever I go to my political Twitter, they all bow out like, oh, we're here for puppy Twitter. We're all nice, sweet people. Political Twitter is kind of evil. So I personally love social media. I love that access and I love that ability to just jump into conversations. But it is, a very small sliver of the American conversation. I think I use it to inform the other things that I find interesting. And it sort of says to me like, oh, I just read this person's article, or oh, this conversation was so fascinating. We should look into this for a story. And it's kind of a good place to start. So I guess I use it as a starting point. And again, I'm only a media critic in that I can be mean to people sometimes if I think they're not doing a good job in journalism on social media, but like there are actual media critics, like Jay Rosen, right? He's a media, like he's a thoughtful, intelligent media critic.
Right.
I am just a gal on Twitter who sometimes gets pissed off at journalists undermining their own industry. Right. Sometimes you see some of these things on social media and you're like, oh my God, do you want to kill your industry off? What is wrong with you? What is wrong with you? But I guess that's all part of, being part of that debate.
Do you think there are other things that, that journalism as a business is doing to kill itself off? I mean, especially when it comes to local journalism. I mean, we've seen new local papers continuing to die off.
Yeah, but I don't think that's journalists doing that. I think that's business doing that. I think that becomes a very hard business. And I think journalism didn't really figure out how to become sustainable. The New York Times brags a lot about how they're able to have these digital subscriptions, and they're right. They've done a very good job in actually making people want to, subscribe to the New York Times. I don't think local news has been able to figure that out. And I think the window on that, on figuring out how to monetize that has closed a while ago and people didn't quite figure it out. So you have a lot of these, groups that are buying newspaper chains or trying to figure out how to make them financially viable when maybe they're not supposed to be financially viable. Maybe they're just supposed to cover what's happening in the school board meeting and in the town hall meeting. So I do think we're in a crisis on that front.
What is next for you beyond the podcast? What are you hoping to accomplish? What do you have your eye on?
God, I just want to get through coronavirus. I want to get through a global pandemic.
In this election.
What are you trying to do? I'm trying to get through
survive.
The election, a global pandemic. I feel like
I don't know.
Getting through would be enough.
Write a book.
So much pressure on me.
It's just a question.
Jump through the camera. One thing I've really liked, and I think one of the reasons I said yes to this podcast, was I like figuring things out. I think our podcast in another 3 months will be different than what we're starting with, and another 3 months after that, as we try to figure out the medium. And my reporting career was like that. I started and then I was like, oh, I think this is what I do well. Oh, I think this is how I should use this medium to tell stories differently or better. And so I've really always liked just tackling new things, as long as I like the people and I like the opportunity. And I think I'm going to continue to do that. I had a girlfriend who called me because she got a full-time job, but she's also an entrepreneur. And she was like, I don't know what to do. I just can't decide. And I said, you know, you're in the entrepreneur's dilemma, right? On one hand, wouldn't it be great to have a full-time gig? But you love piecing things together. You love solving problems. You love negotiating deals and having five things going. And at the end, she turned down the full-time offer because I think she really felt like I like having a lot of, you know, irons in the fire. And I said, I get it, because I'm the same way. I never say yes to exclusive deals because I like trying different things and seeing what is a better platform for me and kind of what I want to explore and how I want to tell stories. We're building in my basement a little podcast and TV studio. That even sounds too dramatic. It's a box, basically, that you could do Zoom calls in. Maybe that's a better way to put it. But because now, you know, I think we'll be doing podcasts for a long time as we figure out how we want to tell stories and what's the right format for me. So I don't know. I think it's kind of nice. I like being able to pick and choose and pick the people I work with and say, oh my goodness, no, we should not work together with the people I don't like, which is kind of a luxury. And just, you know, working on the projects that I think matter and need my time and skipping the things that I think don't matter and don't need my time.